those of you who doesn't know, I photograph theater and dance here in New York, and mostly downtown theater and dance. And so after years of photographing and getting to know the community and the people who create this work, I got very inspired, and I thought how to take it to the next level and show people in a different way outside of the stage and outside of the character that they show on stage. And so I wanted to do portraits of not only actors and dancers, but also people behind the work, choreographers, lighting designers, stage designers, producers. And my idea was clear to me, but I had no idea what I'm doing. Like, how can I show this? Even now. Perfect timing. How can I show this work, and how can I show people outside of the character, just as them themselves? And, okay. How many men does it take to run a projector? So just going forward, maybe you can just put from the second slide, because I'm out of text. But my first idea was to photograph people inside of their own space, like studios, rehearsal spaces, temporary studios. At this point, that was supposed to be a picture. That's still not happening. Another bitch. Ah! This is how we're gonna see it. perfect opportunity to do it was going to Molly and Eleanor rehearsal space in the Governor's Island and shoot them right after they came from this picture performance. And we can play it. Okay. So, and then I went to Lita Studios in Bushwick and Catherine Temporary Studio. And then I realized that no one else has studios or places where they work. And so I invited people here and to my space in Gowanus, and I set up the same kind of setup, like same background, same lighting, and I still was like, but how do I bring the personality out? Like, and people also didn't know what to do. So another idea was, I was asking people to bring something special to wear, special short or dress, something that has memories. And at that point, I got pretty excited about it because, you know, I wanted to see what they bring. And I also had very high expectations because I thought that, well, it's experimental theater. Are people going to bring crazy shit? I was surprised, but not in a bad way. It was still very beautiful. And the stories that people told about the pieces they brought were very touching. You're going to see Brandon in about 10 minutes. Then I realized that there's a lot of couples in this community, and people wanted to come as a couple and take a portrait as a couple. And I guess the whole, like, today asking people to wear something was kind of like way to start a conversation, because even I photographed a lot of those people on stage, we never talked for years. And so by telling them, please wear something, we had like a discussion already. And then because I'm shooting film, stuff like that happened, which was completely unexpected. But as a couple, good couple for and people came with collaborators. Just before that, brothers. And what else happened? Then we went to this whole prop thing. I was like, maybe bring a prop. Like Kristen, for example, brought this banner that she was doing right before she went to the protest. Also, the project started right after election. So the first people who came all had crazy faces. And Kristen was one of the first, so she literally was going to the protest after this session. And we used flowers that was in the studio. Jeff came in a scooter or motorcycle, and I was like, okay, that's the shot. I asked Sybil to bring her costume from her show that she's doing now at Whitney for the next few years. This glass, I think, is from kitchen that Evan took because he was working there. And Amy brought the piece that she created many years ago and was just in the closet, and we just kind of gave it new life. Yara brought a costume from her last show, La Medea. And then was Radio Hall. That went all out, all out. Like, this is what I was expecting from everyone, by the way. There was fake blood, there was this stuff that I don't know the name was, but apparently all the kids play with it now. And yeah, I mean, I'm still recovering my floor from all of that, but it was amazing, it was great. And of course, we had to do this next picture, just because. Then after all that fun happened, I was like, okay, let's get real, let's photograph emotions. And also because I was posting all the photos after each time on Instagram, people got to know what I'm doing, and I think got more relaxed and be like, okay, it's gonna be cool. I don't need to like, I can actually show who I am. So, and also going in deeper in the conversation where the emotions would come from. And I tried not to like tell people what to do and just wait what they will do. And then during that process, a lot of dancers came, and to get them kind of out, I thought maybe I asked to them to do like their signature moves or just the hand gestures that they usually do, which was very interesting because we do them automatically, so no one actually know what their gesture is until start to think about it. So that was an interesting process. A little bit similar to the clothing, to like just see how people take the instruction and what they bring, because it's about them and not about the character that they directed to show. And then my favorite photos were the photos where I didn't need to tell anything. People just sat and that was it. And so I started this November 16 last year, and my goal is to go till the end of this year. So far there was 130 people who came to my studio for the photo. And I photographed with a medium format film camera, so everything is on film, and it's only a few shots per person, so I can kind of be serious about it and not just snap around, which I usually do. And my plan is to, next year, try and publish a book and do exhibition with all the photos and the photos that I will be shooting till the end of the year. That's it. Thank you.
started as a place that I took Stuart. Stuart and I met online on the internet very late. Yeah, I think I was probably looking around because I was bored and my sex life was all on the ground. So. He didn't have any pictures on his profile, and I liked that. I think I knew it was going to be sexual, but at first he said he just wanted to talk. And I love to talk. I'm always talking. So I started taking Stuart out there as often as I could, you know. Whenever we could, we'd pack up the car and just drive out there. But then Paul found out about it, and then it became a place for all three of us. Our getaway. It was total shit when we got it. And it smelled like shit, too. It was terrible septic out there. Inside the toilet would come up, and sometimes it would come up through the drain in the shower, get between your toes where you're trying to clean yourself. We were able to fix that eventually, but there were a lot of other problems. When I first went out there, I was the first one, there was a fallen tree that had come down through the roof and was laying in the bedroom. In the kitchen, we laid parquet floors. It was parquet. And then I used to keep bees out there also. I was out there the most. So as a kind of way to deal with the cabin fever, I started just kind of survival streak, jamming, pickling, thinking of honey. But I put the bee houses too close to the front door. One afternoon we were all having sex in this warm season. But there were wonderful parts too. There were just the three of us. You know, when I think back to the formation of that group, I have to ask myself questions of intent. Sometimes I come to the conclusion that I just don't know what I want. But other times I think it's that I want too much. Greed got no great factor. And these weren't other white people that I was with. So then the question of intent becomes really magnified. A woman in a health food store once called me a sexually imperious. My friend said I had a fetish. My mother said, yeah. The house was separated from the main road by a 2-mile gravel path with all these great pine trees dotting it that made it darker and darker as you got deeper and deeper into the forest closer to the house. The town could not have been more hostile towards us. And it was a small town, so word traveled fast, and I was doing so much work on the house that I was spending a lot of time in the hardware store. And that is actually when I met my neighbor, Tony. After we met at the hardware store, he started poking around the house a lot. At first, he was kind. I was there alone when he first came by, and I tried to explain to him that we were out there, you know, not for business, that we were there for pleasure. So something like that. Oh, we have our business in the city. So, he knew a lot about chickens, and he was trying to convince me to raise them out there. And I think about a year of him, I just agreed to it. But the last minute after we built the coop and everything, I just did not bring this coop to the end, so I brought in peacocks instead. Well, that really pissed him off. But after a while, he started coming at really odd times. despite the fact that most of the people who were living out there were assholes, the thing that really categorized them more than anything else was their desire to be left alone. So anyway, we hadn't been out for a while. Paul and Stuart had been fighting. And I think that I suggested that maybe all three of us go out together. That is when Pelican strangled one of the people. And then everything sort of snowballed. We were naked.
Showing us some of your works in progress. First, I just wanted to sort of kind of pose a question to you guys and think about what I noticed between all your works together in this grouping is that you're all kind of playing with genre and with discipline, and it's really fascinating. And I was wondering if each of you could sort of talk about how you chose sort of your specific genres, music, sort of dance, performance, portraiture as its own performative act, in a way, and we'll start there.
Yeah.
Hello. Well, as I talked in the beginning, it was just interesting for me to photograph people outside of the character, outside of the stage. But as a genre, I would say that the format, the film, and the camera was actually the genre I choose, if we're talking about genre, because it wasn't just a headshot. It wasn't just like beautifying someone and someone looking at the picture instantly and saying, oh no, this is not my good side, like let's try it from here. It was just, you come as you are, I'm not gonna do any retouching, there will be no Photoshop. You can put makeup if you want, but I don't care. And you're just gonna sit and we're gonna talk and what comes, comes, and we will not know what's gonna happen with photos for like a week until they're out of the lab. And that was the choice of genre for me, just because I think that requires more intention in what's happening, and also just sitting and relaxing and being present in the moment without being constantly aware of how you look and how other people will see you.
Almost like a like purposeful uncertainty.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think for me, just as an artist, in terms of some of the stuff I created earlier, I started writing kind of like historical fiction, and then I started doing more contemporary stuff. As I got kind of into the spoken word scene, I started doing more music-oriented stuff. And so I started with like historical fiction and then contemporary, and then I just was really interested in kind of imagining the future. And I feel like for this project in particular, it was about me wanting to kind of combine my loves for science fiction and hip hop and see that kind of combined together. And you kind of look at the landscape too to see like, all right, has that been done? Has that been done a lot, you know? And so that was a large part of it. And then also too, like it started with the music, because this particular piece, it's, you know, it's an album, it's a web series, and now this is kind of the final installment of it is this live show. But it all kind of started with me creating the beats and then the lyrics and then me kind of going from there and having it kind of expand.
Great. Sean?
Yeah, I think, well, there's two aspects to that. One is just from what my own interests tend to be, but you know, I definitely first come at performance from more theatrical way, from text and sort of, I love to try to deal with work that's like kind of confusing you as to what is being performed and what's not in terms of text and character. But then I work so much in dance that I've been really interested in trying to push dance theater in different ways, I guess, because typically when I've worked in it, in my experience, it's often more choreographically driven. It's a lot of dance artists who work as dance theater makers. It's the complete generalization, but that's been my experience. So I kind of come at things from the opposite side a bit, so I'm trying to find out what that means. For this piece in particular, I'm actually, one of the reasons I wanted to put these two things together is that I'm actually trying to push that more, and I envision something that is a lot of, the way I'm imagining the piece is like many ways to say goodbye to something or to someone. And I'm trying to figure out a way that a piece can have film, not video, but like a film, and then this kind of storytelling, and then something that is really sensory, something like a movement exploration that you say goodbye to a space by putting your whole body inside of it. So I'm really curious, it's a good question, because I'm really curious about this. I'm like trying to figure out ways to either fully integrate them or make an evening of a piece that actually is like very episodic. It's like, let's explore this way, but that could actually, then maybe by the end there's a band on stage and it's a concert.
Yeah, I think that's a really interesting topic, and kind of what leads me into my second question is you're all sort of working in between the folds of other things and really pushing things together to sort of make some third entity happen, and you're all working with guests, with the creative team, with collaborators. How do you begin a conversation like that? How do you sort of convey those moments of uncertainty and in-betweenness that may not even be clear to yourselves?
Is it me again?
Sure.
Well, for me it's easy because everyone who comes, I either photographed already or will photograph, and it's already in the calendar. So it's naturally a talk about what you're working on right now, or did you went to see that piece, or you were great in that thing. And that, I guess, just starts the conversation. But the funny thing is that because, especially when I started the project, I didn't really talk with anyone. Like, I usually just come and it's dark and I shoot and I leave. And so after all that small talk is over, there's this pause where it's like, okay, now we're just two people here, and yeah. And so I guess, I don't know, I just let that be as a kind of a breeder, and just, yeah, it's okay not to talk or not to ask anything or just be.
Yeah, I think it's been a challenge in terms of, wanting the piece to kind of be like a hip hop solo concert as well as kind of like a theater piece. And so I think we have been really working at trying to find the happy medium for that. My director Andrew, we've been really going over just creating the plot, and then sometimes it's too much plot, and so we kind of have been really going back and forth. And Noel's also been very helpful from the Bushwick Star in terms of being able to figure out what's the balance between being able to do something that is still very music fueled, but still has some degree of story there that the audience can kind of hang on to.
I think, I guess in some level, I try to push myself into working with people that are, it's scary, but are better at things than I am in certain things that I want in that work. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, I mean, I'd asked to work with Brandon because he has a kind of even more sophisticated movement vocabulary than I do. So it's kind of like, and it is a scary thing to say, okay, I'm going to ask you to go with me on these things that I'm not quite sure about. I mean, on one level, at least for now, I try to also surround myself with people that I trust already. So we work together a lot with other artists. So
we've kind of had to figure out that unknown thing together on other processes already. So there was already, we already knew how we worked with each other on something like that.
I wanted to ask about that as a sort of collaborator on a friend's project. Obviously there's a level of trust, but in terms of sort of jumping into the unknown with them, do you guys have tactics of sort of, or is it just history that sort of leads you to be able to sort of collaborate?
I think history is a huge thing. Mm-hmm. And then I think I try to at least make a separation with the friendship, or it's just kind of like, okay, I think a good tactic is just to at least have some clear ideas of what you really want to do. Right. So that doesn't just feel like a hangout session that extends into rehearsal.
Do you guys have anything to say to that? In that case, I wanted to ask you guys if you had any questions for our audience. This is a work in progress showing, and these pieces are very much in the stages of creation and continuation. Is there anything that interests you of hearing people's responses to your own work?
I have something.
Yeah, please.
It kind of speaks to what you were saying earlier, which is that I'm, as I kind of mentioned, I'm purposely trying to work with ways in which a piece can shift quite dramatically, and become sort of not eat itself a bit, or become something else, in ways that are like working with jump cuts, or that suddenly you go into something else. So, this is just two pieces of things that I've made that I put together next to each other, but it actually contains that kind of transition, contains something that I'm curious about. So I guess there's no right or wrong answer, but obviously I'm not looking for like, oh, that was great. I'm more just kind of curious about what that experience was like, this first part, which has a much more of a feeling of this kind of like atmospheric dance theater, and then to this direct address that feels unknown as to whether I'm just talking to you or delivering a monologue, or that's my question.
Would anyone like to share a response to that end?
Said jump cut, because to me it felt like a long crossfade, uh-huh. And it's kind of, I'm not even sure we completed the cue, if you will.
Yeah.
Like it was always kind of moving like that for me.
Okay.
I also, in movement and in musical theater in particular, we talk about the failure of language and how we move to song or we move to dance or whatever to do what language can't do. And I appreciated the aversion, there was a point where there was a failure of the body. I can't remember with this thing anymore, so I'm going to resort to the thing that I know best, which is my words, even if it's a crutch. And I love that.
Cool. Thank you.
No. I like the piece is so much about memory, and the first part I felt very much like I was almost in the memory, like in your mind, and then that transition to more of a mode of telling a story, like articulating memory, but I felt like these kind of two ways of
pitfalls or anything that you would want to ask for feedback on in terms of how you're structuring or how you're affecting people with the sort of musical theater that you're doing?
Well, I would say we spent a lot of time, again, on like figuring out like the plot and what's working and what's not working. So I told Andrew, I was like, I'm a little feedbacked out because we've been really going at it about, all right. I mean, and the reason why is because I've written this entire kind of like epic thing about these robots, and so I have a whole Bible, right? And so it's difficult to figure out, all right, well, how can we do this with it just being a solo show? How do we do this without, how much of this can I just explain without video? So, I mean, that's really has been like the challenge in all of it. And so I think, you know, us just continuing to kind of figure out, we're spending a great deal of time just on clarity and things like that. And so, I don't know, I mean, I guess I could ask just about takeaways of like, okay, what were the things that, you know, were most memorable about what you saw?
Mm-hmm. Anyone care to respond to that, sir?
You're recording.
Yeah.
So, the takeaway, that's an interesting question. It's a question I often ask myself. What do I want people to walk away with, take away, and think about after? And on your piece, I've been exposed to hip-hop and rap, and I love just kind of the science fiction element of this, how you dance through life and you come up with these robots, bro. To me, it tickles my imagination. That's what I take away.
I'm really glad you said that, because one of the things that we talked about, this is recently, so again, when you're doing this process, you're trying to figure out, okay, you're articulating what it is that you want to do. And so there was a point when I had said there are three goals for the show, which is, you know, one, for it to be fun, for it to be, two, for it to be uplifting, and three, for it to allow people to use their imagination. So thank you for that.
Yeah. Anyone else? Jasmine?
Music as a device for success was so nice because it gave a reason for the language and for the music to exist rather than, it influenced the plot, and I remembered why it was there, which was really, really nice, because I think sometimes it can feel a little masturbatory, and not in your piece, and that was so, so exciting.
Yeah. Thank you, I appreciate that.
Janine, did you have a response?
I think the moment that I remembered most, or I felt the strongest emotion during, was when you were saying I don't know exactly what the line was, but something like, I came from the future to help you figure out how to survive. And I kind of wanted to know more about that. I don't know if maybe you just wanted to leave that mysterious and for us to kind of imagine what may have happened in your future that you've had to come back and, you know, tell us something.
Well, that's why it's a whole show. So you gotta, yeah, so good. That's good though. Thank
you. A whole show that's happening when?
At the Bushwick Star in February through March. Yeah, thank you, Andrew.
Great. Maria, is there anything for you?
I mean, It's hard to ask for any feedback about this project, because it will be like a feedback about people who on the photos, and that's kind of weird. I was like, oh yeah, like, you know, you should shoot more of those people, well, not those people. But if anyone wants to say something, I take any feedback. That's what I'm saying.
Well, with that said, is there any questions for any of the artists on stage after watching their performances? Great. Mark?
Did you record your talks, or was the only aspect that's left is the film?
Yeah, that's the great question, and I actually halfway through thought that maybe I should have recorded it or do a video, but I didn't. And so it's just a film. That's it.
That's great. And Sean, when is this piece of yours going to come together? When is it, does it have a place it's going to perform?
Yeah, it's going to be at the Bushwick Star also. in the spring of 2019. So, a year from this spring.
Great. Thanks a lot.
In May, I think.
anyone else before we wrap up? If not, thank you so much for coming. Can you get another round of applause for great artists? Thank you. Studio visit with the Builders Association in just about a half hour. So please stick around and join us for that. We'll see you guys around. Thank you.